This is June 23, 1995. The survivor is Joseph Aleksander. The interviewer is Mary Rothschild. We are in Los Angeles, California, United States of America. It will be conducted in English. It is June 23, 1995. I'm Mary Rothschild interviewing Joseph Aleksander for the survivors of the Shoah Visual History Foundation.
This is June 23, 1995. This is tape number one with Joseph Aleksander. Please give us your name and spell it.
My name is Joseph Aleksander, J-O-S-E-P-H-A-L-E-K-S-A-N-D-E-R.
When is your birth date?
My birth date is August 3, 1923.
Where were you born?
I was born in Warsaw, Poland. At that time, my name was Joseph with an F. At the end, I also had a middle name, Leib, L-E-I-B, and my nickname was Lolek. My friends used to call me Lolek, and my relatives and so far. But after the war, I dropped the word Lolek, you know, I wasn't too crazy about it.
Tell me what you remember from your childhood, please.
Well, what I remember from my childhood is that, you know, times were not that great most of the time. It was during the Depression, and things were very hard for most everybody. And I remember wishing for many things that I couldn't have, even as a child, for a nice rocking horse and nice toys that I didn't have. And then later on for nice clothing, which I couldn't have. Most of the time I wore hand-me-downs from my brother. So times were quite tough. So anybody that said that Jews were all rich, it's not truth, you know.
What was your brother's name?
My brother's name was Joel, J-O-E-L.
How old was he?
Joel is 1 year and 2 months older than I am.
Were you close?
We were pretty close, not really that close. My brother had his own friends, and I had my own friends, I guess because of the age difference. Slight as it was.
Can you describe the home you grew up in?
Well, we had a not a very large apartment. We lived on a second floor, and it was one very large room, basically, and a kitchen and a bathroom. And the room was kind of divided by with the moving walls, so into separate quarters for my parents and for us.
What were your parents' names?
My father's name was Abram, or Abraham, and my mother's name was Paula, and Jewish was Pesa.
And what language did you speak at home?
I spoke mostly Polish at home. My parents spoke mostly Yiddish to themselves, but Polish to us, for some reason, so that I really didn't learn to speak very well Yiddish until later on. Actually, I really learned to speak Yiddish well once I was in a camp, the first camp.
How did your father make a living?
My father was a buyer in the textile field, and he used to get orders from out of town, from many small towns, and he used to fill the orders from the wholesalers in Warsaw, and ship the to make packages and ship them to the merchants in the small towns all over Poland. So that was basically what he was doing.
What did your mother do?
Well, my mother, as far as I remember, in the beginning while we were growing up, was a housewife. But then later on, when things got very tough, you know, like in the late 1930s, she went to work for a company that was making corsets, you know, for women foundations, foundation garments. And then after a while, she learned how to do it, and she started manufacturing it herself. And then at the end, she had like two girls sewing. They had about three sewing machines. They used to sew those corsets, and she used to go and to different well-to-do houses, women, and she used to fit them for it, because over there it was mostly costume made. It was not like here that you go to the store and you get it ready made. Over there it was just like a suit. Over there you had it made. So the same thing was with corsets. So once she started doing that, we were doing a lot better financially. So she was a big help, actually. Right.
Were your parents religious?
Well, my father used to go to the synagogue every Friday night and Saturday, and he insisted that we go to, of course, on all the high holidays. And he used to put the tefillah on every day, so I guess that he was religious. But he didn't force the religion onto us. And somehow or other, I never really became religious. We used to observe Friday night and Saturday, and we used to go to the temple on all holidays. But of course, as kids, we couldn't wait to get outside and play ball. You know, we couldn't wait for the time where the kids could get out. You know.
What do you remember of Friday night?
Friday night, remember the candles and the fish, gefilte fish with the chicken soup and all the good stuff. And then my mother used to make chulent every week. A big pot of chulent, and my brother and I used to take it to the bakery Friday. And then Saturday morning or at noon, we used to go and pick up the chulent. And I remember the smell was always so good of it, you know. Used to wrap up the pot with paper, and the paper was all brown and crispy after the chulent was baked. This is what I mostly remember about Friday night and Saturday. Pleasant memories.
Did you live in the Jewish quarters?
Well, the neighborhood that we lived was mostly Jewish, but it was mixed. There were some Gentiles, but I would say probably about 75-80% Jewish in that area.
Were they religious?
There were always, you know, there were secular people and there were religious people, you know. We were probably considered secular, you know. There were some people that, you know, they were Hasidim, you know, with the, you know, long beards, and but it was mostly secular. And we used to play soccer, you know, which is, we used to call it football a lot on the fields. The neighborhood that we lived, it was not far from a big empty space. It used to be called Platz Broni in Warsaw, and we used to spend a lot of time there playing. Also, there were a lot of parks. Park Trauguta, you know, was over there. So, as I remember from my childhood, a lot of games and playing and chases and all this kind of stuff.
How about your school? Where did you go to school?
Well, I went to school. For a while, I went to a Jewish school, which was Bermana school, you know, the great school, but I guess they couldn't afford it. So they sent me to, my parents sent me to a regular grade school. And it was mostly Christian. There were only about three or four Jews in the class in that school. And that wasn't very pleasant, because
Why?
We used to get beat up all the time by the Polacks.
Did you ever get beat up?
Oh, yeah, many times. After a while, we kind of learned to be tolerated, but every once in a while, when a new boy would come in, he had to, you know, start beating up Jewish kids, you know. But mostly the Polish kids were bigger than we were, because they were older, you know.
What were they saying to you?
Well, mostly they would say, Parshive Zhidje. It means you lousy Jew, you know. And as a matter of fact, it comes to my mind now, but they used to teach catechism there, and they priest would come to teach catechism in school, and he would say, "Parshive Żydzi, wyjdźcie stąd." You know, it means the lousy Jews get out of here. You know, that was from the priest himself. Yeah.
How so old were you?
Well, I started school when I was 6, and in the grade school. You know, that much I remember. And then I after this school was over, 7 grades of this school, I went into trade high school, which was a lot different because we were all Jewish there, because it was supported by Jewish trade organizations. You know.
So how old were you when these anti-Semitic incidents happened in school?
Oh, starting about 6 till about. Till about 13 or so, you know.
Do you remember what were you feeling? What were you thinking?
Well, were feelings of fear, you know, because you were many times my father had to come and pick me up from school because you were afraid that they will gang up and beat you up, you know. And I also remember on vacations was the same thing, you know, if you were someplace where, you know, there was majority of the Polacks, you know, you were always afraid of getting beat up. And also on the streets of Warsaw, you had to be careful where you went. Because if you went to a Polish neighborhood, it was dangerous. You know. My brother was very tough, you know, he used to defend me. He was a real tough kid, you know. You could fight 2-3 of them at one time. It's very strong.
Where did you go on vacation?
Well, they usually, we used to go like to camps, you know, like a summer camp, you know, to Kazimierz and other neighborhoods, you know. And that was pleasant, it was nice, you know, because the reason was nice because we were all Jewish. There was nobody to beat us up. Unless you strayed out of the camp someplace, you know, then you had to be careful. Yeah.
Where were your grandparents?
Oh, my grandfather was very religious. I still have his picture. He had a long white beard and pious, you know. And he made his living as a teamster. He was driving horse and wagon, you know, wagon with horses. That's how he made his living, you know. But he was also active in the shul, in the synagogue.
And what was his name?
His name was Shachne Schulman. Last name was Schulman. He was a very nice man. He was a very nice man.
Where did he live?
Also in Warsaw.
Did you see him often?
Yeah, we saw him quite often, yeah. Sometimes I used to go there and stay with him, you know. He was a very nice man. And I have memories of him bringing us toys sometimes, you know. Little shovels, you know, to play in the sand, you know, when we were young. He was a nice man. He actually went to Israel in the before the war in the 30s, and while I was still young, and I understand he had to work very hard in Israel for a man his age, you know, and that's what hastened his death. He worked as a pioneer there.
What happened to your grandmother?
My grandmother lived down for a long time for. She died, I think, in her 1960s or something like that, quite at an advanced age. She also died in Israel. Yes.
Mm-hmm. How about your paternal grandparents?
I never knew him. I never knew anybody from my father's side. I understand that he had family in this country, somebody, but I never met anybody, you know, from his side of the family, mostly. Only from my mother's side of the family.
Was your father strict?
No, he was a doll. He was very soft, very soft-hearted. He could never go buy a beggar without giving him some money. A very good-natured, soft-hearted person. Both of them were, actually. And my mother always said people at home that were worse off than we were, you know? And they would stay for a night or many nights, and she used to feed them. A very charitable person. Yeah. And I remember many times when we didn't have it, other relatives took care of us, you know. People would help each other.
Where did you go to school when you became 13?
I started going, I went to, I think at the age of 14, I went to this school called Szkoła Rzemieślnicza in Polish. It was like trade high school. It was, we had half a day of theory and half a day of practice.
What kind of practice?
Was on a low level of machinist work, you know, mostly working by hand with files and hammers and drills, and then at the end going to more advanced machinist work, running all different, you know, like lathes and mills and shapers and machines of this kind, you know, at the end.
Did you like it?
Well, I really didn't like it that much, to tell you the truth. But my father felt that I should have a trade. He says, he used to say, a man, a balmeluche in Jewish means a tradesman. A balmeluche will always make a living, he said. So that's why that was his influence on that. You know, in Europe, you didn't argue with your parents. You did mostly what your parents told you to do. My brother was sent to a business school, so he developed in that direction.
What were your dreams? What did you want to do?
What did I want as a young person? I don't really remember. You know, I believe just for a better life, I suppose. My greatest love was sports. I used to belong to a club called Maccabi, and we used to do gymnastics and group gymnastics. And we used to, as a matter of fact, once a year they had like a performance in a circus, and we used to do gymnastics there. And I used to do track and field, and I enjoyed it very much. That was probably my biggest love, is my great, you know, belonging to Maccabi and being amongst other children my own age, you know, or young men and women my own age, and doing gymnastics and doing track and field and swimming. I think that was probably my brightest side of my life in Europe at that time. Because we didn't even have a radio, you know, in those days. No less TVs and everything like they have now. And I used to read a lot. I always loved to read.
What did you read?
Oh, my favorite books were Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, Zane Grey, and basically everything about Lawrence of Arabia and all this, anything that had something to do with adventures and with the Wild West stories and all kinds of stories like that. And then I love to read. I used to read almost a book a day, because basically that was the entertainment in those days, as we didn't have radio and TV and tapes like the children have now.
Do you remember any close friends?
Yes, I had very many close friends. And unfortunately, I don't know any that survived. We had a good close circle of friends. And as the ghetto closed up, you kind of lost sight of each other. And after a while, there was nobody left. See, what happened to me is that I got sick in the ghetto when they started. Shall I start with the ghetto already? Are you ready for that?
Before we go there, do you remember any incidents of anti-Semitism before the ghetto?
Oh yes, many incidents. Many incidents. Like one year I was in a... my parents used to send me out to, in summertime, we had some relatives that lived in small towns, you know. I forget, near a river, Bug, you know. Near a river, Bug. I was once surrounded by a bunch of Polish kids, and they had... They beat me up with oars, with you know, they had like a boat, and they used the oars to beat me up. And they were not happy until I started crying, and then they let me alone.
How old were you?
I was about 13. Actually, the reason I was there because I had my bar mitzvah over there. Brzeszcz nad Bugiem was the name of the town. Because my parents couldn't afford to give me a bar mitzvah at home, so they sent me out there. It was a lot cheaper. So that's one of the incidents. And there were many incidents in the city, you know, that being attacked by Polish kids and the names, you know, that they used to call us. Excuse me, can I have a drink of water?
What were the first signs of trouble?
Well, I'll tell you that the first signs of trouble were that the anti-Semitism in Poland really grew to a very big degree. And as a matter of fact, there was a boycott of anything that's Jewish. And the Cardinal Wyszyński said to boycott the Jews is okay, you know. So the business really got bad, and the attacks of anti-Semitism were very bad. So that actually when the Germans started attacking, some Jews thought maybe it'll be for the better. It couldn't be much for the worst. Little did we know.
What happened to you and your family?
When? At that time?
Yes.
Well, when the Germans came in, well, my mother was still doing her trade for a while. My father couldn't do anything anymore. It was his business kind of died down completely. So thanks God my mother was doing still her business. She used to go to the Polish ladies who had the, you know, were well off. And she used to, you know, work for them. After I graduated from school, I started working in a tool and die shop as an apprentice doing some of the work. And then the ghetto started, you know, they started closing up the ghetto.
How old were you at that time?
Well, in 1939, I was 16. See, the school was a three-year school. So I actually graduated at 16. I was the youngest. Most kids were 17. And then as the ghetto closed up, I went to work for a factory that used to make carbide lamps. And used to supplement the income, I used to sell lamps to friends. You know, I used to get them very cheap in the factory and used to sell them to people that we know because we still had some friends. We still used to get together. In the beginning, the ghetto wasn't as terrible as it was later on. We still had friends and we used to get together and we had our dances, played ping pong and volleyball because it wasn't as tightly compacted as it became later.
Describe the living conditions. Were you able to stay in your own apartment?
For a while we were, until they really, but then they started closing off the ghetto, and that was making it smaller constantly. So then when they, uh, took away the area. See, we lived right on the border of the ghetto. The street's name was Sherakovska Ulitsa, you know. And it was right like on the edge of the ghetto. So we were one of the first that were taken off. Then we went to live with some relatives, some distant relatives. And that was harder. And I became very sick. I had a fistula on the edge of my rectum. And to be sick in the ghetto wasn't good. So I had to soak and doing this. And there was no real medical care there. And that was very tough. And then they started the raids, you know, they used to pick up people on the street and send them to Treblinka. And one of those was my father. They picked him up quite early, I think it was around 1940, 41. He was one of the first that they picked up. And as a matter of fact, unfortunately, the Jewish police used to help in gathering the Jews.
How did you find out they picked up your father?
Somebody told us that he was in a group of people that they circled around, you know, and shoved them into I think it was a streetcar or something, and they took him away. And we never saw him again. Otherwise, he wouldn't be away, you know. And we never saw him again. So that was the first thing that I lost, my father.
How old were you?
I was about 17 at that time. So at that time, about 17. That was a tragedy. And then they started tightening the ghetto more and more. And I was still sick. I couldn't walk. But at one time, we even went out of the ghetto to work for Polish farmers at the beginning of the ghetto. I'm going back now a little bit, when they first closed the ghetto. You could still get out. So we went out to work for Polish farmers. And I worked for a few months. But then we saw that there was a war coming up between Germany and Russia. So I was standing, the place that I was working was the Polish Ukraine. And there was, you could see the German army massing and coming into Russia. So we thought we better come and go back home. So we went back to the ghetto. Because like I say, in those days we didn't know that it's going to be so terrible. So we went back to the ghetto. We had relatives that we stayed with. And they owned like a wood, small size wood mill where they made wood molding and boards. And on that, on that lot of that mill, the Germans came to recruit people for work in a labor camp. I found out about it because one of the girls from that we stayed with, one of the young women, she told us about it. And I couldn't go there because I couldn't even walk, you know. My fistula was really bothering me. So she put me in one of those rickshaws. You know, they were like a bicycle-driven rickshaw. And she wheeled me over there on that lot. And I had my diploma from school that I graduated as a machinist, journeyman. So when the Germans were selecting the people to go and work in the labor camp, I presented my diploma and they took me, which was a big break to get out of the ghetto. And in this way, I saved myself for the time being.
What happened after you left for the labor camp?
Okay, when the labor camp, it was a relief because at least we had a couple meals a day. And the only problem was that we had one very rough German guard who used to love beating up people. You had to stay out of his way. And then we worked on trucks, and large trucks. Actually, I didn't do that much. I was a young kid, but there were a lot of older experienced auto mechanics and truck mechanics, Jewish, who really knew how to work. And we even had blacksmith who used to make springs for those trucks. And machine shop, I did do work in machine shop. And then we used to cook our own meals because they used to give us supplies, and we had little stoves in the rooms that we used to, that's how I learned to make stew over there.
Where did you sleep?
Oh, we had bunks. There were like three or four men to a room in the bunks. So actually it was a big improvement over the life in the ghetto at that time. And there were some men that used to go outside and smuggle in stuff, although it was very dangerous. And there was one man who used to was a real bon vivant and used to go out and visit his girlfriends, and he thought he could do anything. But one time they caught him and they shot him, you know. So he pushed his luck too far. And they did it publicly so that we could all see what can happen. And then at one time, one of the men that ran away from camp, he ran away from the camp, and we didn't know what happened to him, and he came back about 6 weeks later, smuggled himself back in, into the camp. And he started telling us the stories that they picked him up in the ghetto and they took him to the to Treblinka. And he told us that they were exterminating Jews in Treblinka, whole train loads full. They used to strip him naked, and they drove him into those chambers, gas chambers, and then they, he was one of the ones that used to take out the gold teeth and the jewelry, things like that. And that one time, what he did is he sneaked into a railroad car that was, clothing. They were shipping back the clothing to Warsaw. So he sneaked into that railroad car, and that's how he saved himself, you know. But when he came and he told us about it, you know, people wanted to beat him up. They thought he was crazy, that he's trying to stir up trouble, you know.
Nobody could believe
about it. We were all aghast, you know, we just couldn't believe. We did start believing a little bit, but mostly we didn't believe him, and they called him the Meshuggah, you know, the crazy guy, you know. So that was really hard to comprehend that something like this could happen. And then, so we were there for about a year, and then at that time...
What was the food like?
Well, they used to give us potatoes and a portion of meat, and some bread, and some margarine. So it wasn't that bad, really. And then we were able somehow or other buy some food from the people that used to smuggle in the food into the camp. So it wasn't that terrible. Of course, nobody got fat, but we didn't starve.
What was a typical day like? What was the name of the camp?
The name of this camp was Luftwaffe Mokotow, and it was in an area of Warsaw called Praga, which was like an, let's say, like here you would say North Hollywood, you know, was about that distance from Warsaw, you know, and it was on the other side of the river, River Vistula. Well, we used to get up in the morning and we had to stay on the on the Platz, you know, where they used to, you know, count us over and over. And then the Gestapo man would come out with his whip and his dogs, and he would have a big speech, you know, how we have to behave ourselves, and, you know, really reading the riot act to us. And then we would go to work for 8 hours or 10 hours. And then we would have a little free time to sit and talk or whatever.
What did you do at work?
Well, mainly what I did, I used to run the, you know, clean the brake pads and clean the parts, you know, that were to be reused, wash them and clean them, because I wasn't that experienced in the auto mechanics that some people were. So I was mainly as a helper. And sometimes we had to do some digging if they wanted to build something, you know, some labor work. But it wasn't excruciating, it wasn't that bad as it was later on, you know. But this didn't last too long, you know, because like I said, it was about a year, and then they took us, they closed up this location. I don't know if they closed it completely, but I know that they took all the Jews and they sent them back to the ghetto, but not to live in the ghetto. They took us directly to, there was a railroad station, Gdańsk, used to be called Dworzec Gdański, means the Gdańsk station, you know, railroad station. And over there were a lot of Ukrainian soldiers, and they drove us and they drove us mercilessly, you know, here and there and here, you know, pushed us around and beat us, you know, with rifle butts and all that. And they took whoever had a watch or a ring, had to surrender to them, you know, by force. And there was the prelude to being shipped out to Auschwitz from there.
What year was it?
Was around 1942, I would say, 42. One thing I remember, there was, I met a young girl who was about my age, dark-haired, beautiful girl, and she was so petrified, she was shaking all over, and she was so scared, and she asked me, you know, we kind of got introduced, and she said, please take care of me, help me, help me, help me. So I said, I'll do whatever I can, you know. What could I do, you know? But I guess she needed somebody just to lean on.
Where did you meet her?
Right at this station, railroad station. It was like an Umschlagplatz where they transferred people to go to concentration camps. But then after a while, the thing, after a while, when they drove us into the railroad cars, then I lost sight of her, you know, because you had no choice where you went, wherever they pushed you. And the railroad cars, they just had little windows on top, barred with barbed wire. There were maybe two windows on top, and they packed the whole car with people. So it was unbelievably hot and stuffy that you couldn't hardly breathe.
How many people?
God, hundreds of people they shoved in a wagon. You know, cattle cars, you know. But they were not open. It would be good if they were open, but they were closed. And I remember when we took off, the only nice thing about it, you could hear the railroad whistles, you know. You know, which was the only pleasant thing you could hear is the railroad whistle. And then during the night, I lost my I don't know if it was a night or in the daytime. I think it went like 2 days and two nights. And I lost consciousness. And what I remember to this day, the dream that I had, like that I was laying on a field of green grass with a river or a brook. To this day, I remember that. I guess I was dreaming of something that I would like to happen to me. But it didn't happen. Then I when I woke up, I must have passed out, you know. I woke up and they opened the doors and they started slow pulling everybody out, you know.
Who was that?
The guard, the Nazis, you know, the SS. With the skull and bones emblem on their heads, you know. And on their epaulets. And a lot of people never came out of those wagons. They were dead. Because they were laying like layers on top of layers, you know. Well, I was young and strong, and I think that's why I survived. You know, a lot of people didn't. And as they unloaded us, that was Majdanek, Lublin Majdanek. And they, I'll never forget, you know, whoever couldn't make it, they shot him. And in my eyes, they shot, there was an old lady, she was maybe in her 70s, or maybe in, you know, in those days people looked older, you know, maybe in a, she looks very, she could hardly walk, you know, so an assessment pulled out a gun and blew, hit her in the, shot her in the head, and I could see the brain splatter all over, you know. Never forget to this day. And so that was Majdanek, and they marched us to Majdanek. Majdanek was like a death camp, you know. Very few people survived Majdanek. Was mainly beatings and work in the sand and the gravel and digging. And there were a lot of Ukrainian guards and Polish guards who used to beat the prisoners. They called them Häftlinge. And they used to stand, you know, if they want to kill somebody, they used to put a board across his neck and just rock on his neck until he died, you know. It was mostly Ukrainian and Polish guards there. But luckily, I wasn't that long over there. It was only about 6 months, I think. And from then...
Where did you sleep while you were in Majdanek?
They had those barracks that had like layers of wooden platforms, like shoebox, like a shoebox, you know. And you were laying on wood, you know, basically. There was nothing under you, just boards, you know. And that's how we used to sleep. And the food was very, very little, there was very little food.
What was it?
A soup, which was usually mostly water and cabbage, maybe a little pork in it, very little. Maybe a few little potatoes swimming, and a piece of bread a day. That's about all it was. Over there. A lot of people died there constantly.
What did you do during the day?
There was also a crematorium there too. Oh, mostly they used to drive us out and told us it was just useless work, you know, just dig here or dig there, and it was nothing really creative to do. It was mostly just digging and loading and digging and loading. There was nothing creative over there. It was just mostly like a death camp, you know. But I guess I was lucky because I wasn't there that long, you know.
What were you wearing in Majdanek?
In Majdanek, as far as I remember, you know, they were like cotton with stripes cloth with a little round hat also with stripes, you know. Like prisoners used to wear in the olden days here, you know, cotton. It was summer at that time, I remember, so it wasn't cold.
Does any incident stand in your mind from your time in Majdanek?
Well, there was only one incident that stands in my mind. Before I left, you know, when we went to the ghetto, it comes back to me now, I did see my mother for a short time, you know, and she gave me a gold coin that she saved, a $20 gold coin. So I had it with me, but when I went to the Majdanek, there was nothing to do with the gold coin, you know. So I had a relative there, I was a kid, you know, I had an older relative, and he says, if you give me the gold coin, I will see that you have food, I'll buy it. So I gave him the gold coin, but I never saw anything. He just took it, you know. So people were mostly, well, this particular person, you know, was not that I looked better even before the war, like a con man, you know. So I entrusted him because I knew him, you know. And I never saw, I don't want to mention the name because his relatives are still alive. So no use bringing it up. So that's what stands up. But also what steps up in my mind is like when they drove us to work, watching the guards torturing the prisoners, you know, laying a 2x4 across the neck and rock on the throat, you know. So this is probably what stands out in my own mind. And always trying to be someplace else where the guard was, you know, trying to avoid Yeah. And the speeches that they gave us, the Polish, the guard, the Polish guards, that will never survive this camp. We better get used to the idea that this is the end of the line, you know. In Polish, in the Polish language, you know. That this is, that we'll never get out alive.
What happened next?
Well, what happened next, that they loaded us up into railroad cars again, and they took us to Auschwitz. And when we went into Auschwitz, you probably saw that well-publicized gate, Arbeit macht frei, you know. I saw that gate, I went through that gate, they drove us through it. And they made us strip completely naked and hold our hands to show that we have all our fingers. And then Dr. Mengele was standing there.
How did you know he was Dr. Mengele?
Well, I didn't know him at that time. But from what I hear the descriptions now, there was a young, tall, good-looking, handsome guy, brunette, you know. So it must have been him, you know. And we used to run back and forth, men and women, naked, you know. And he would tell you, go this way or this way, this way or this way. And, you know, I was, like I said, I was athletic, I was young.
How old were you at this time?
I would say probably 18 or 19. So I was sent to go to labor, to the labor camp out of Auschwitz, which was called Bunawerke. And my mother was sent, I saw my mother there too. And my mother, I saw, she was also in an area closed off, you know, but I haven't seen her afterwards. So I was sent to this called Bunawerke, which worked for a German, big German concern called IG Farben Industry, which was making ersatz gasoline, you know, and artificial gasoline and artificial rubber and other products like that. And because I was a machinist, you know, I told them, you know, when they asked me, they send me to a machine commando, so that I, you know, so that I would. But actually, what it was, we didn't really do any machinist type of work. What we did is helping German structural technicians and engineers who were, setting up electrical high power transformers. Things like that, you know. And so we would carry the transformers for them, and we would carry the acetylene bottles, you know, for welding, and things like that. And so that wasn't quite as bad as people that had to work in outdoor heavy work. And but unfortunately, that didn't last, because an incident happened that almost, you know, ended my life there. Myself and another man were carrying a heavy transformer, which was about 5 feet long and very heavy, you know, must have weighed 120 pounds or something. We were carrying it up on a beam, on a narrow beam. I was holding one end and he was holding another. And all of a sudden, it slipped out of his hand and I couldn't hold it myself. So it crashed to the floor, and when the German capo said, "Was ist los?" You know, what happened? He pointed at me. He says that I dropped it. I said, "No, I didn't drop it." But because he was the one that initiated it, you know, so they believed him and they kicked me out. And they sent me to the, what they call the Tod Commando, the death commando, which was working all day, loading heavy lorries, they call them, you know. There were those wagons, you know, railroad cars that kind of tilted sideways to dump out the dirt, to tilt it upright to load them up. And we had to work all day in the hot sun with very little food, you know. And when you work hard, you need more food. So a lot of people were just dying there, you know, getting too weak. And when you got too weak, they send you to the crematorium. So I felt that life ebbing out of me, you know, that I will not survive. After about 3 days or 4 days, I said, I'm not going to make it anymore. So I took courage. And the Lage Eltester, who was the head of the whole of the whole camp of Bunawerke, was a big German, and he had a green triangle which indicated that he was a Verbrecher, which means a criminal. But he was the head of the whole camp. He was a big, about 6 feet four or something, like big giant man. And so on Sunday, when we didn't work, I took courage and I went and I walked up to him and I stood upright and saluted him. And I told him in German that I would like to have a few words to tell him. So he let me say, and I told him the whole story. You know what happened, that I am by training a machine schlosser, and that I'm dying there in this, and what purpose do I serve? I said, at least if I work at my profession, I will serve some purpose for Germany, you know. And he took down my number, you know, which is 127915, and he wrote it down. And the next day, they called out my name and they sent me out to another commando, which was also a technical commando. So that's what saved my life. Because I spoke up, because I had the courage to walk up to him. Because everybody was terrified of him, you know. He used to give people a zets, you know, and knock him down, you know. But I guess it worked for me. So then I was sent to another commando, which was a lot better. We used to transport acetylene bottles and oxygen bottles, which they use in welding. And so that was a lot easier. And I worked closer with some German technicians, craftsmen.
Do you remember any of their names?
No, I don't remember. But I remember there was one man who used to bring me a sandwich almost every day. It was a German. He was one of the craftsmen, but I guess he had a heart. So he used to bring me a sandwich. He used to share his lunch with me every day. So that, I guess that was a bright side of it, you know. And that lasted until the Russians started getting closer, and we could hear the artillery booming, and also the planes were dropping bombs all around in Buna. And we were hoping it would drop on the Germans. Unfortunately, I think they missed. But they did damage the factories, you know, the installations.
What year was this?
I would say probably 1944. Yes, and the Germans were coming in closer and closer, so they evacuated Auschwitz. And they gave each one of us a ration of bread to go on the road. So I sewed myself up a little sack that I was hanging from my neck inside my shirt, because people would steal from another, you know. Anybody would steal, I don't say anybody, but many people would, to save their life.
What kind of clothes were you wearing?
Incidentally, going back to Auschwitz, as I remember now, we were talking about it before. They used to bring Jewish people from all over Europe. And the characterization, like we talked about Jewish people from Italy, they had it the hardest over there because they were completely unused to the hardships And the second group of Jews that had it very bad were the Dutch Jews from Holland. They were all very well educated, very refined people, very nice people. Unfortunately, there was no demand there for refined and nice people. It was dog eat dog, you know. So they didn't last very well either. And then the Hungarian Jews came in. And Hungarian Jews only spoke Hungarian. They didn't speak any Jewish at all. Consequently, they didn't make any friends with the other Jewish people. And myself, I learned to speak Yiddish in the labor camp. And as I stayed on longer and longer, I perfected my Yiddish. Because you had to get along with people. And so that's what I wanted to bring up. It came to my mind, you know, how different Jewish people from different parts of Europe were better equipped for this hard life. Ourselves being from Poland, we always had hardship from the Polacks. So we were used a little better to the hard life. Also, many Jews from Poland did work as craftsmen and did the work as they had. They were oriented into the physical work more than the Jews from Italy or Holland or Belgium or other fields like that. The Jews from Belgium did speak Yiddish, most of them, you know, because I guess their ancestors come from Eastern Europe. So you ask me what we were wearing. Okay, here's something good to bring up. We were wearing summer and winter was just a blouse, you know, a striped blouse. I don't know, was cotton or artificial cotton, I don't know, and pants and underwear, you know, sort of underwear. And which in the summertime wasn't too bad when it was hot, but in wintertime when we had to work, was freezing cold. And wintertime they did, as I remember, they did give us like a little cotton overcoat, which also wasn't very warm. And we had a hat, a round hat with the stripes. And so what we were doing, we had contact with cement because we had to load cement railroad cars and unload cement, railroad cars with cement. So we used to take the empty bags from cement, and we used to cut out holes for the arms and for the neck, and we would slip it, shake it out good, and slip it under our clothing. And also I would take the cement, the bag, and cut it out in strips and wrap up our legs and our torso, you know, to keep the wind out.
Did it help?
It helped a lot and insulated us, but the Germans were against it. And if they caught somebody, you would get a whipping, a beating. But luckily, I wasn't caught. So all winter, I was wearing cement bag underwear up and down. You almost did everything you could to survive. Sometimes it was a different whether you stood in a windy place or went into a place that wasn't windy. You know, it was that much difference when you're weak and tired and hungry and all that.
What happened to your shoes? What kind of shoes were you
wearing? That's another problem, the shoes. They were killers. They were klumpen, they used to call them. They had wooden soles and leather, just leather thongs on top, strips on top, you know, to hold them. Or they were all, you know, like closed on top, you know, but it was wooden soles. And it was a torture to walk in them, you know. And I think that's what ruined my legs, because I had varicose veins and afterwards. After the liberation, you know. But there was a torture walking in those shoes, with wooden soles.
In Auschwitz, it's 1944. What happened?
Well, getting back into the life of Auschwitz, you know, that the daily hardship of getting enough food and as I remember, we used to get coffee there, which wasn't fit to drink, and I used to brush my teeth with that coffee, you know, because it was something warm, and used to get a slice of salami, and a slice of bread and a bowl of soup, you know, which if the man that was dishing up the soup liked you, he would scoop it down from the bottom and you'd have something, you know, to eat. If he didn't, if he didn't know you, he would give you from the top, it would be mostly water. So it was a daily struggle to getting enough food. We used to sneak behind the kitchen to get some potato peels so we could eat the potato peels just for sustenance. And then periodic, another thing that happened to me in Auschwitz that I had a toothache a couple times and I had some bad teeth. And of course they didn't bother fixing them, they just yanked them out. You know, that's how I lost some of my teeth. Because once you start losing teeth, it affects the other teeth. And my teeth got progressively worse and worse. Another time I remember that I was eating some bread, and it must have been spoiled bread because I got deathly sick. And my temperature shot out way up there and I was feverish. So they took me to the hospital and they pumped, they shoved the tube down my throat and they put some suction on it and they emptied my stomach, and that's what saved my life, you know, from the poison food. So, and then there was the daily struggle, you know, every once in a while they grabbed you to unload railroad cars with cement bags, and they were quite heavy. They were like 60-pound, 70-pound bags. In the weekend condition, you know, it was quite rough to carry it. And that's how situation was. A lot of some people tried to escape, and they got caught, and they got hung. They gathered us on the Umschlagplatz, and we had to watch the hanging of those people. And I remember one man, he was kicking, you know, he didn't die fast enough, so one of the Germans pulled on his leg, on his legs, yanked on him to make him die quicker. And also this standing on the Umschlagplatz every day, which was like a torture. You know, they kept you for hours while they counted back and forth and back and forth to make sure that everybody was present. And if somebody wasn't present, if they thought they were missing somebody, you stood another hour or two to make sure that they find them. They send out a search party to look for the people. And so, like I said, this was a very hard part of it. And like also walking to work in those wooden clumpers, wooden shoes, was like torturous, you know.
Did you talk to your friends, your comrades at night?
Yes.
About what would happen during the day? Do you remember any of those conversations? What did you talk
well,
about?
Well, mainly what we were talking about is about the families, where we're from, and what was your father doing and your mother, and just you know, you had to talk to somebody, you know, this, and basically that's what I remember. And I remember that there was a sort of dislike, unfortunately, between one group of Jews and the other one, like the Hungarian Jews didn't like the Polish Jews, and the Polish Jews didn't like Hungarian Jews, because I guess it was the language barrier and the way of living and different. And but otherwise there was nothing much really entertaining or anything in this life, you know. And basically that went on until like I said, that the Russians were getting closer and they evacuated us. Like I mentioned previously, they gave us that ration of bread which I hung around my neck, and that was in the death of winter. It was very cold, freezing, and then we had to walk in the snow. And the stragglers, you know, people that couldn't keep up, they couldn't walk, weak, or women, you know, that were hanging back, we heard shots continuously. They were shot, you know, they couldn't keep up as the group. And at night we were huddled together to try and keep warm. And then one morning I got up and my ration of bread was gone. Apparently somebody must have snipped off the string from while I was asleep. And here I was faced with not having anything to eat at all. But I was walking together with a young man from Slovakia. He was a Slovak. And when I told him about my problem, he gave me half of his ration bread. And he wasn't Jewish even. But he shared with me his ration bread. Maybe that's what saved my life too. And then after we got, I think it was Breslau, you know, where we got to. Who was alive? They packed us into open railroad cars. It was in winter, but they were completely open. And it was snowing on us. We were huddling together, trying to, you know, keep from freezing. And they drove us to Buchenwald. And then in Buchenwald, when we arrived at Buchenwald, they sent us to, there were like enormous barracks, huge barracks. And when you walked in, there was like a huge hangar, almost size, you know. And on each side, there were rows of those wooden pallets stacked up maybe 6 or 8 high, you know, like you put merchandise in. And there was no straw or anything, you know, just on it. And we were packed like 6 to a pallet, so you could only lay on one side. So you could lay a few hours on one side, then we had to all together shift over to lay on the other side. Till you got sores on your bones from laying there, you know. And basically there was no work there, you know, it was just warehousing us. And then at one time or another, I don't remember the place, while we were in Buchenwald, they shipped us to another area of Germany, which was like in a mountainous area. pardon me, where they had factories inside mountains, like dug excavated into the side of mountains, where they had a railroad coming in there, and they had machine shops. And I remember I was working on a machine there on a lathe, making parts. I don't remember what they were anymore, but something for the defense, I guess. And they kept us there for a while. And then they...
How long were you there?
I would say probably about 3 or 4 months or so.
What were the conditions like?
Over there, there was a beautiful area, you know, it was like in mountains, like you see a picture card, Courier and Ives type of winter picture card with mountains and trees, you know, Christmas trees and everything, you know.
What country was it?
It was in Germany, but it was in a mountainous area. I don't remember, you know, nobody told us what it was or where, you know, you were just a piece of machinery to be moved around, you know. Nobody told you, here we're going here or here we're going there, you know. But it wasn't that bad over there because we did work inside, indoors, and we, the place where we slept was a lot better, nicer. Unfortunately, that didn't last. They took us back to Buchenwald in the railroad cars. And when we arrived in Buchenwald, was already towards the end of the war. Because we could hear every day artillery, you know, coming closer and closer. And that everybody saying, oh, the Russians are coming closer, the Russians are coming closer. We didn't know who it was, whether it was Russians or Americans, but we did hear the artillery. Actually, I think it was the Americans. But when the war was coming closer to Buchenwald, they started marching people out. They used to gather people and told them, oh, with a loudspeaker, they would announce, we're going to take you to a better camp where you get better food, better living conditions. And whoever volunteered, they would take him and march him out into the forest, and they would shoot him there. They used to shoot the people, just to get rid of witnesses, you know. And we could hear the shots, and the people came back. Some people came back and said they were all shot, and they were doing that all continuously every day. So myself and some of the people I was with, I think it was three or four of us, we hid under the foundations of the barracks, which was half mud and half dry, you know, was mostly muddy. And we laid there for like 4 days without any food whatsoever, just so they wouldn't take us and march us out, because we had a sneaking suspicion that if they do, we'll never be alive again, you know. So we were there like for 4 days until one day became very quiet, you know. And then we peeked out and the Germans were gone. And all of a sudden the tanks, you know, just crashed through the gates, American tanks. They were the American soldiers. And we were so emaciated, you know, we couldn't even stand up. You know, we were just laying around. But we were so happy that finally we were liberated. The curious part about it is that my brother, who lived in America, was amongst those soldiers who liberated Buchenwald. But he didn't know I was there, and of course I didn't know he was there either. But that's what I found out when I came to this country and I talked to him. And so when they liberated us, of course they gave us food and we got very sick.
What did you eat?
They brought us Spam and bread and good soups and, you know, real good army food, you know. And we got so sick, you know, dysentery, you know, because the stomachs were not used to this rich food. And shortly after that, I got what they call in German Fleck fever, which is like a typhus. And they took me to a hospital in Weimar. There was a town named Weimar in Thuringen, which is near Buchenwald. And I was in that hospital for a few weeks, and I had such a high fever. What they used to do, they used to soak sheets in ice cold water and wrap me up in those sheets off and on to bring the fever down. And then finally they did bring it down, you know. So I recovered from that. And after that they sent me to for convalescence, they sent me to they took some German homes which they used to place convalescing survivors. And I was in one of those homes to convalesce. And that's how I survived. And after a while, we started walking the streets of Weimar, and the Germans had it quite well. I mean, even if they lost the war, you know, they had plenty to eat and everything, you know, they had restaurants open and everything. So we were walking around, and that's how I met my wife first. I saw her standing in front of one of the houses. She was living with her girlfriend. And that's how we met. And we just met one time, once or twice. And then I didn't see her. Incidentally, what happened, the Germans took over Weimar, Thuringen. They took over this whole section of Germany. America gave up the section of Germany to them, to the Russians. And when Russians came in, all of a sudden we didn't have any rations because they took the food for themselves, all the supplies. So it became tough. But the Russian soldiers had plenty of money because they requisitioned the printing presses that printed the marks. So they had whole sheets of marks. So I became friendly with some Russian soldiers. They were quite nice guys. And because I spoke Polish, which is similar to Russian, and I picked up some Russian from them, and I spoke German, I was like an intermediary between them and the German, especially German girls that they wanted to meet, you know. So I used to introduce them to the German girls and so. So they gave us some marks, you know. So that made it a little easier. We had some marks to spend. The Germans, to the German, the mark was a lot of money, and the Russians had whole sheets of them. They were not even cut, you know. So that comes to my mind. But after a while, I was with a few friends, and we decided to get out of the Russian side because we felt if we were going to be in the Russian side, sooner or later they'll send us back to Russia. They did send a lot of Polish people, Polish Jews, back to Russia. So we wanted to get out in the worst way. So one time we got on a train that was going from the Russian zone to the American zone, and but they caught us. So
who caught you?
The Russians, because they, when the Russian train stopped at the border, they asked to see your papers. When they saw that we were Polish, Jews from Poland, they didn't let us across. They didn't want anybody to get out. So the first time they caught us, they just gave us a lecture. So said, if you try again, you go to jail. But we waited a few days, and then we got back on, and we tried to sneak in a warehouse railroad car, a railroad car that was used for shipping merchandise and stuff. But they caught us there too. And this time they put us in jail for 24 hours. Said, next time we catch you, you'll go to Siberia. So what to do, So, but we did have some marks with us because of those Russian soldiers. So we bought our way. There was a group of Germans repatriating returning soldiers who were imprisoned in Russia and were released in Russia. And they wanted to get back on the other side to their homeland from the Russian zone. And we were wearing the UNRWA uniforms, which were similar to German uniforms. They were kind of khaki green, Of course, without any insignias, but they looked, and we spoke perfect German. So we got mixed up with this group of Germans, and they had professional guides who were trained to smuggle people across the border. And we, we asked to be smuggled across as well. And we smuggled the whole night through. They had scouts. They sent out to find out which point was okay to cross, and we crawled on our stomachs through the bushes, and finally they got us on the other side. So then they passed the hat for a collection. So the poor German soldiers had barely a few pfennigs, but we had those German marks, so we gave them, and they thanked us, and they thanked us. We told them that we were, the reason they tolerated us, because they could tell who is a native German and who isn't. But we told them that we were Volksdeutsche, which are Polish people of German origin. That's why we had that accent, because they can tell who is German, who isn't. We told them we were Volksdeutsche, that we're escaping, that we want to go on the American side. And that's how we got across. And then we walked, and part of the way we walked, and we hitchhiked from Weimar until we got to Stuttgart, because Stuttgart was a major UNRWA camp, and there were a lot of people from Radom and Stuttgart, and one of the people that I was with was from Radom, and he heard that was a lot of people from Radom, so we went to Stuttgart, and it was a lot better in Stuttgart because it was an UNRWA camp, was plenty to eat, of course.
It was a DP camp?
A displaced person camp, yes, I'm sorry, I forgot to tell you. It was a displaced person camp run by UNRWA. And American UNRWA officers, who worked in UNRWA. And while we were there, and I asked to, everybody had to do something. You couldn't just sit around. So they had an opening in the camp militia. So I asked for a job as a camp policeman. Of course, we were not armed or anything, just stand and watch the lines where people standing in line for food or supplies. And then one day I go, there was a restaurant on a corner. The name of the street was Rheinsberger Straße. Whoever was in Stuttgart will know that immediately. And there was a Bierstube on a corner, which is like a beer hall and with food and everything. They had delicious German food, German soups and everything. Of course, we went there a lot. And one day I walked in there, and there is my wife, Johanna, again. So that was like a sign from heaven. Here is somebody I saw 1,000 miles away, all of a sudden I see her here, you know. So that's when I fell in love with her, you know, second time around. And she used to sing and dance. And life, actually, that year that I was in the displaced camp was probably one of the best years of my life.
Why?
Well, because we were free, we were young, we were dating, which I didn't have much time to do before because of the war. We were dating, we were dancing, we were singing, and we were carefree, you know. There was always food and decent clothing, you know, halfway decent anyway. So, in other words, was like about the only time in my life that I look back that I had a carefree year. And then we got married there. I don't know, that's where you want me to break off, or?
Was anything ever made of the fact that you look German and you speak German?
No, but many people, you see, coming back to Poland, coming back to Warsaw, a lot of people ask me, why don't you go on the Polish side, on the Aryan side, they call it the Aryan side. Now the reason for that was, frankly, is that the Polish people could tell who was Jewish. I don't know by what magic. And I used to speak Polish perfectly. I was at the top of my class in the Polish language, essays and everything. But they could tell who was Jewish. And if they saw a Jew, they would point out right away to the Germans, Jude, 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 you know. Sometimes they got something for it, sometimes they just didn't like Jews. They wanted to point the Jews out to the Germans. And when you did get caught on the Polish side, you usually got shot. You know, they just took you out and shot you. So it was a question of risking your life and being shot or going along with the flow. And frankly, I choose to go along with the flow. I know some people that went on Polish papers, Polish side. But one reason also was why I couldn't intermingle with the Polish population is because we had no Polish sponsors. You had to have somebody who would be willing to protect you, to save you. Now my mother, who looked 100% Aryan, you know, not Jewish, you saw her pictures. She had many clients, Polish clients, who were well-off Polish people. They lived in estates with a fence and a gate around. And she went, when the Germans started tightening up the ghetto, she went begging to them that they should protect us. And they wouldn't do it, you know. As a matter of fact, in one place, they sent the dogs after her. And she got bit by the dogs, something terrible. You know, we had to put compressors all over her arms and legs because that woman had a few bulldogs and she sent them after my mother. Although she pretended always to be a great friend and a, you know, good customer, and she loved that she liked my mother and everything. But when it came to the crunch, it turned out what they really were, you know. And one reason the Polacks were interested in getting rid of the Jews is because when the Jew was sent out to concentration camp, they could come in and take over all their belongings, all the valuables. They had a free hand. And so that was one reason why this happened. As far as me being not looking Jewish, maybe it did help me in concentration camp. Maybe if I looked really what the caricatures, depict as Jewish with long noses and so far, maybe life would be even harder on me. I don't know. I cannot say that. But I probably suffered as much as anybody, you know, regardless of my looks. But I also remember when they first grabbed us, when they were taking us through the Warsaw Ghetto to the Umschlagplatz, which was where they were gathering the Jews to send them to Majdanek and to Treblinka. As they were marching us, there were Polacks standing around and calling out all kinds of derogatory expressions like parshive zhije. You know, it's good that they're taking you away. Even little, as I remember, comes to me now, children in tailor tats, in walkers, who were maybe 2-3 years old, already were also already calling palshivi zhije. They couldn't say palshivi, they would say palshivi, you know, like children cannot pronounce the R. But even the little kids were indoctrinated in this anti-Semitism, unfortunately, you know. So this was said because I think that maybe if the Polish people would not be so happy to cooperate with the Nazis, if they would at least close their eyes, many, many more Jews would be left alive, you know. Even we don't even talk about hiding out, but just close your eyes, pretend you don't see him, you know, so they could live their own life, you know. But unfortunately, it didn't happen. And the Polish police was very anti-Semitic. I'll never forget in the ghetto I saw an old lady was selling, had a basket of bagels to sell. And I guess they had to pay off the Polish police, and she maybe didn't pay off because he dumped a whole basket of bagels into the ground and he stomped on it, you know, crunched them all up, you know. This poor old lady, you know. That's probably all she had in the world. So that's coming back and answering your question.
What was it like for you as a Jew, a survivor of a concentration camp, living in Germany?
Well, it was good and bad. Of course, it was good that we were free. We could go wherever we want to. We could take the streetcar and go. We played soccer, we played volleyball and basketball and the playgrounds. But also what bothered us a lot is that the Germans were living wonderful. They still had their beautiful homes, villas. I used to walk around and envy them. You know, here they have a beautiful villa with a fence, with a gate and dogs and everything. So really the war in many instances didn't affect them that much. I suppose with the exception of the ones that got bombed out, you know. But they lived a very good life, and this bothered us a lot. And also they had the German police who also were armed, you know, walking around, you know. But like I said, I wasn't in Germany that long. I wasn't interested in doing any business. I was just interested in leaving as soon as possible. So
when did you come to America?
Well, when I proposed, you see, what happened is that I remember I had in my mind one address that I remember when my brother left in 1938. It was an older cousin. It was my mother's first cousin. It was my second cousin, but she was an older lady. And she wanted to take us both out of Poland into to America. But my mother couldn't stand the thought of losing both sons at the same time. So she allowed my older brother to leave, and she insisted that I should stay, because she meant well. It didn't work out that way, unfortunately. But I remember that one address, which was in Denver. They lived in Denver, Colorado. So after the war, I wrote a letter. I also remember an address in Israel. From my grandmother and my grandfather, my aunts that I had there, that left in the 30s. Well, coming backing up a little bit, like I said, I knew those two addresses, so I wrote a letter to Israel, and I wrote a letter to my cousins and my brother in America, and they both wanted me to come over there. At that time, I wasn't married, and I proposed to Johanna, and she said that she would marry me if I come to America. So America it was. So I made my decision, and we got married in May the 8th, 1946. And then we applied for the papers previously. And my relatives in America said, "Why do you want to bring a wife? We have plenty of girls in America. You don't need to bring a wife." But I said to them, if I can't bring Johanna, I'm not coming either. So they agreed to that, and they made me the papers. And then we got married, like I said, after we got married, there was just us and then Johanna's brother and his wife who were the witnesses. And we didn't even have a glass to break. You know, we didn't know, we were just a couple kids, we didn't know the ritual. So we came here on an army transport ship, Marine Perch. I think we arrived on June the 22nd, 23rd, one of those. And we came to America. We were in Hotel Marseille in New York. We were quartered there, you know. They gave us a room. And then some of our cousins came to see us there. And they gave us $5 each, which was like a fortune to us.
So today is 49 years since you arrived.
49 years since we arrived, this month, exactly.
Today?
Today, yes, it's that's June right, 23rd, yes. Correct. Should observe it. We'll go out for dinner. Anyway, so when we came here, we stayed with my cousin for a while. Oh, first we were in New York for about a week. Then we stopped over in Denver. We had some cousins in Denver. So we stayed in Denver about 10 days. And, you know, just to meet the relatives and see everybody. I'll never forget, they had a barbecue and they had steaks. And the steaks were like rare, medium rare, and we couldn't touch it. And they couldn't believe how we could not eat it, you know. And of course, our clothing was all completely out of touch with America, what we had. But anyway, when we came, and then we came, next stop was Los Angeles. We stayed with some cousins here. And frankly, they couldn't wait for us to go to work, you know. Unfortunately, they were not the type of cousins that would nurture you, you know. They thought they've done their responsibility by bringing us, by helping us to come here. Because we would have come here anyway through the UNRWA, even if they wouldn't, because UNRWA brought people over here too. So we had to go to work. Not speaking the language was very hard. I spoke a few words, but not enough really to communicate. So I just went. I took a streetcar. Remember, we lived in the neighborhood of Santa Monica Boulevard and Beverly Glen. And there was a red streetcar, and I took the streetcar as far as it went, and it stopped in Hollywood area, in the industrial section. So I just knocked on the doors and asked for a job, and that's how I got a job. My first job was like working in a company that made costume jewelry, doing assembly work, you know. That was my first job. And then I worked, and Johanna told you a hell story, right? So I don't have to repeat what she did. But my second job was working for a company that made stoves here in this, and I worked at a punch press, putting metal into the punch press and then letting the punch press form the metal. Until I saw one person lost four fingers on his hand, so I quit. But the hard part was getting a place to live here, because there were very few apartments because of the shortage due to the GIs coming back from the war. So we had a very distant relative who owned a building, a triplex in Long Beach, in Belmont Shore. So he let us have a smaller, what they call a bachelor, single apartment, actually. So we went to Long Beach, and the only job I could get was as a busboy in a restaurant. And then I graduated to be a waiter. But I had to be away from home constantly, being a waiter. I had to work Saturday and Sunday and Friday night, you know. So we decided to quit that, and we came back to Los Angeles, and I got a job at Mattel Toys as a mechanic. Mattel was owned by my cousins, Ruth and Elliot Handler, you know. So they gave me the job. I got a job for $1 an hour, which wasn't much money really, even in those. That was 1950. Like, no, it was 48 actually. 1948. So I worked there, and as it worked out, I worked my way up to I became a machinist and a model maker. And from model maker, I became a technician. And I started going to college evenings. And I took several courses in physics, manufacturing processes, and mathematics, algebra, and statistics. And I worked myself up to being an engineer. And I was a test quality audit engineer. Then I was a reliability and product safety. And that's what I did until I retired, basically. You know. But the way we got ahead in America, which is not through basically being on a job, because that wasn't enough really to get ahead, but just to make ends meet, like you say. But with in 1952, we borrowed money from my cousins, the Handlers, and from a couple friends, two of our friends, and we bought our first house, because that's what we strive to have our house. And then we saved a little money, and we bought a house. We bought an old house in Culver City for like $8,000, which was a wreck. And we patched it and painted it, and I put new windows in, I put a new roof on it, and we sold it and made a couple thousand dollars. And from that, we bought another house, and that's how we gradually worked our way up, you know, until we could buy some income-producing property, you know, which basically helped us to achieve the status of living that we have now, thanks God.
Joseph, do you have any children?
Yes. I have a son, Alan, who was born in April 1948, so he's now 47. He's an attorney. And I have one son, Michael, who is 43, and he's a repairman. He does plumbing, electrical, carpenter work, and he does quite well. And I have two grandchildren. One is Daniel, who is he's 12, and Derek, who is 10. Thanks God for that.
Whose children are they?
Alan's. My youngest son is not married yet. He's a bachelor. And like I said, we had a very hard time with our grandson, Daniel, who was born very much premature. Did Joanna tell you? Yeah, no? Yeah, he almost died. He only weighed like 2.5 pounds. And then after a while, he only weighed 2 pounds. And they had to operate on him, perform a colostomy. But thanks God that he survived and he's okay. So we're grateful for that.
Why do you think you survived?
Well, I think one reason I survived is because I was young and strong, healthy. And another thing is that I was lucky. You know, but you know, it's a lot of people who were young and strong died too, of illnesses and being shot or being beat to death. You know, so I guess it's a combination of being in a good physical condition at the right time, and also being lucky that I was sent to a place where I could work, and also I think to a great measure at the right time. That I had the courage to speak to the Lagerältester, who was the Lagerführer, you know. And because when I knew that I was going to die, and I had enough courage to speak up, and consequently being transferred to a better place of work. So there's many aspects in it. And they say in Jewish, Bashert, right? So that's what it is, because I'm no better than all the people that got killed, you know, that were sent to Treblinka and right away, you know.
See. From your experiences during the war in concentration camps, is there anything that you learned that you want to pass on to your children, grandchildren, and future generations?
Well, I would say that the most important thing in the world is tolerance, you know. We hope that people learn to be tolerant of each other, regardless of the religion or color of skin or national or nationality. Because like I say many times, just because you're a Jew, it doesn't mean that you're perfect. And just because somebody is not Jewish doesn't mean that they are bad. It's what the people are. There are plenty good people who are not Jews, good-hearted people, charitable people, just like there are some that are not. And there are many, unfortunately, Jews who are not so good, who can do things that are bad for to other people. So basically, I would say the most important thing in the world is tolerance. And what I would also like to, for personal achievement, I think that hard work and honesty and I would say also prudence, in other words. If you make some money, if you get ahead, it's not important how much you make, it's how much you have left, you know, because it's very easy to make and spend. And we were very prudent in our life. There were times where we couldn't go on vacations and we wouldn't go on vacations. We used to take the kids to the park, and that was their vacation, is to play in the park. So early beginnings were very difficult in this country. They were very hard. But like I said, we worked very hard and we tried to save as much as we could. And we had a good social life because we belonged to the Jewish survivors, different clubs, where we met other people, and that was basically what kept us together from drifting away. I think it was very important.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you for your effort. I appreciate it. Okay, the picture that we see here, at the bottom left is my father.
His name?
His name was Abraham, or Abraham in Yiddish.
Last name?
Aleksander, of course. At the bottom right is my mother, bless her memory. Her name was Paula, or Pessa in Jewish. In the standing in the middle am I, Joseph. At that time was Yosef, Leib. In Polish they used to call me Lolek. And then on the right standing is my brother Joel. In Warsaw he was called Joel. So he is called Joel. And he lives in Minneapolis now. He's 1 year and 2 months older than I am.
When was the picture taken?
This picture I would evaluate it was taken in around 1937.
Where?
In Warsaw, Poland. It's a family picture. Okay, here we see a picture of my present day wife, Johanna, and it was taken in Stuttgart, Germany in 1945. Or 46, and I don't know exactly, and at that time she was 17 years old, and as you see she was beautiful, that's why I fell in love with her, one of the reasons. She also used to sing and dance and make everybody happy. And here we see my picture taken in Stuttgart, I think around 1946. And at that time I was 22 years old. So like, what else can I say? I don't want to brag about myself. Here is a picture that was taken at the wedding of my older son's Alan. And as we see here on the left side is my youngest son, Michael. Next to him is Alan with a mustache. And next to him is Sherry, his wife. Her maiden name was Shantz. Now, of course, it's Sherry Aleksander. Next to her, the tall lady is Johanna, my wife. And on the right am I myself. So that was taken at the wedding about 20 years ago.
1975?
1975.
Where?
No, let's see, yeah. It was in Stephen Weiss Temple, in Los Angeles, know. Okay, here we see a picture of my two grandsons, our two treasures, love of our life. On the left is Daniel Paul is his middle name, and he is now 12 years old. And on the right we see Derek Bryce is his name, and he is now 10 years old. I think at the time that this picture was taken, they were about, I would say, 7 and, or 8 and 6, something like that. So the picture is a few years old.
When was it taken approximately?
He looks to me, Derek looks to me like he's around 6 years old, 5 or 6. So it probably was taken about 4 years ago.
1991?
Where?
In
where they live in Santa Barbara, California. That's where they live. My oldest son is a lawyer there. Otherwise, I wouldn't know. Okay. Here we see displayed on the right side is my affidavit that I was in Stuttgart, Germany, at the United UNRWA camp, and that I was employed as a camp policeman, which was mainly just to keep order and waiting lines and peace, you know, so far around the camp. And this is my document showing that I was employed there. And signed Joseph Aleksander, at that time was J-O-S-E-F Aleksander. Now it's J-O-S-E-P-H. Okay, here is displayed on the left side is as when we came to Stuttgart, we had to have some documents because we had no papers at all, no identification papers. So they issued us these passes so that we could go in and come back, you know, leave the camp and come back in without being stopped. And when we were stopped, we could identify ourselves. So these were the only identification papers that we had. And it shows that there's a displaced person camp, and my name, Aleksander Joseph, and Stuttgart, Germany. And below is the same type of a pass identification paper issued to my wife, and it says Aleksander Johanna, Stuttgart, Germany. And it's issued by the UNRWA camp committee. Okay, this document here shows the upper document is a diploma that I finished a course, a driving school course, which was driving basically a truck. And it shows that I graduated from the course. I passed the course as a chauffeur. And the bottom document is another identification that shows that I was employed at the UNRWA camp, April 30th, 1945 or 6? I can't see. 1946, of course. In 45, I was still in concentration camp. I can't see from somewhere. Okay. So this is basically just a piece of history that shows that I was there and I worked and I did my best. Thank you very much.